So I've had my workout now and ate some lunch, and now it's back to the PCB design. And I found this on the Reddit, and I think it's kind of funny. It's how they made the Belgian Malinois. So my dog is a Belgian Malinois, and I have to agree to most of this. Like it's one of the few breeds of dogs that have still maintained their qualities of a typical, like the qualities that you want in a dog. I think it's like it's one of the best breeds, if not the best, really. I'm gonna go back to the PCB, and my dog has had her workout. Of course, I've had my workout, but as far as the dog is concerned, it was her workout, and that's kind of the theme that comes again and again in dog training. Like you have to do everything you do with the dog has to be kind of structured so that the dog thinks she's doing everything for her own benefit. Whereas the way it comes out, it's always for your own benefit. And then you can have a very fun collaboration with the dog when it comes to training, to working, to doing almost anything. Anyway, I'm gonna go back to KiCad, and I'm gonna continue with the board that I'm working on. This is a motor controller, which I've been designing here on YouTube Live. And I'm streaming pretty much the whole design process live, so you can take part in the chat. You can subscribe to my channel so that you can get notifications about the times when I send live, and you can also come with suggestions about the boards, ask questions, just interact with me and with this design in real time. I have a few connections here that I need to wire up. I'm gonna start with the ones that are sticking out here. I've added a little opening in the ground that surrounds this analog circuitry, and I'm gonna wire up these connections to the control pins. Let's see. So I'm gonna switch the width, and I'm gonna go here. This would be the address of the multiplexer. So this address picks the channel which the multiplexer forwards to the microcontroller. It is an analog channel. So this goes here. And something that I forgot to wire is the actual analog channel, which I should have done before I started wiring all the other things. The analog channel comes out of here and it has to go here. And this is a bit. Yeah. This is not very good layout for this analog channel. Although one of the things about this analog channel is that it doesn't have to have the same kind of precision as, for example, things that are connected to the current sensing of the motor. But it still needs to have, it still shouldn't have any spikes or any kind of coupling from any digital signals that are running here. But the precision itself doesn't need to be more than 256 units. So 8 bits is going to be enough for this. But of course, if we can go with higher precision, if we can route it in such a way that we can achieve higher precision, then that's just a benefit. So let's see. Let me think how I'm going to route this one. Should I perhaps go here? And I think probably the best way to go about this channel is to route it on the back of the board. Because I don't have any other connections close to it, I can route it here. It should be pretty isolated from anything else, and it's going to be separated by the ground plane from these connections here. So, go here, and And I don't have any other connections there, so that I will not need to modify this track or move it anywhere else. That's pretty much how it's going to be. The only thing here is the 3v3 and let's see, the 5 volts, and then there is the control signals for the power circuitry. This needs to, let's see. Hello, Damien. So, it would be nice if I had some space here, which I don't. So basically just the overcurrent and the power enable. Of course I could just switch layer and just go on the power layer across this little gap there on the inner layer and then just continue routing it here, but I don't want to have anything on the power layer. I don't want to have any connections on the power layer besides the power. So what could I move here? Can I move this one somehow? This. Ideally, I should have placed this one a bit closer up, then I would have enough space. This is an analog signal, so and these lines they don't really produce any interference, so they can go side by side with the analog signal. They're not going to be changed during normal operation. They're basically going to have just a DC voltage on them, or zero. I'm just gonna go on the back layer. It's the best way here. I'll just switch layer and route it on the back here. And this can just go here. Yeah. Except without any suggestions from KiCad. And why is that? I'll move them a bit later when I'm done with this. So this will go here, which is perfect. And the other one can just go side by side. I don't think it's enough space there. Yeah, it was enough space. So this can go here. Let's see, this one goes. Oh, yeah. Right, so this is something would be nice to rewire. If I have AP reset, maybe. So I connected this one to the SPI GPIO because I don't have enough GPIO pins on the STM32, and it has to go all the way there. I would rather not route it all the way there. I want to try to avoid any kind of connections that go across many other tracks. So if I can rewire it to something else, then I may be able to just lead it here somewhere. Question is what that could be. Maybe this, let's see. Maybe this one actually is... although if I rewire this one to the other GPIO, then I would have to I wouldn't be able to control this pin. This is a chip select pin, so it's really good to have that pin connected to the STM32 directly. Otherwise, there would be a much longer delay for communicating with this chip, which is not desirable. What else could I rewire potentially here? All of these pins have to go directly to STM32. The fault will be triggered when there is some fault in the communication with the encoder, which means it has to be a fast response pin. Maybe there isn't anything else I could rewire. Right, this one also. I think the way I'm going to do this is just by moving the tracks here slightly out like that, and then I'll move the bias as well, and after that I can have tracks that go on the back layer around these tracks. So this will actually go like this. And then I have the encoder signal, which will have to go around here. Oh, right. Yeah. That's what I did. There is a delay in the chat, so I think it's, I don't know exactly how many seconds. Whose PCB manufacturer services you like to use for your projects? I've used Seed Studio a lot, but I'm going to be trying PCBWay. I think they have a very, they seem to be very serious about both the PCB manufacturing and the assembly. So I'm going to try them, and I'm going to see how fast they deliver and how good of a PCB they're going to make. So it's going to be, for this board, it's going to be an evaluation of PCBWay. Let's see. Okay, so one comes first? GLC PCB. Have you tried them before? So this would be a 4-layer board. It's let's see, it's 21 centimeters times 13. Let's do the default thickness 1.6 and quote now. Alright, you're waiting for the board to deliver. I mean, to me it seems that a lot of these sites are basically copies of the same site. So I almost wonder if this has been a spin-off from Seed Studio, because this is exactly the same interface as Seed Studio. It wouldn't even surprise me if it's the same company that owns this website as well. So let's see. Yeah, 62. I think Seed Studio would do this for 49. Yeah. Maybe they even order from Seed Studio. Like, you place the order with GLC PCB, and then they order from Seed Studio and make $10 on it. I'm just gonna double check, so I'm not just saying a bunch of bullshit here. So 6213 here. Let's go to Seed Studio and take enter the same specifications. So let's see. So Fusion PCB, and let's see what price we get. So we have FR4, 4 layers, 130 times, 21, 10 boards, 1.6, yeah. Ooh. Turns out that Seed Studio was more expensive. Okay. At least for this board. Yeah, it seems everything else is on the defaults. Cool. So, sounds like GLC PCB might be worth trying someday. Let me know how the PCBs look and if they are good quality, if you are taking part in any of the future streams once you get the PCBs. Okay, cool. Good tip. Okay, going back to the board. By the way, have you? It may also be worth finding out if they do assembly and how much they take for that. That will be sort of the next question for me. If they're more expensive in assembly, even though they're cheaper for the PCBs. So I'll have to check that myself if I'm gonna try them. Okay, so or I could actually, I'm just thinking. So I'm gonna have a few of these boards assembled, and then I will probably order a few of them also as just PCBs. So I could actually try GLC PCB and see how well they do compared to PCBWay. That'll be interesting to do. So I'll just order the PCBs from GLC PCB, and we'll see. Can of DCS. Let's see. And can of DINT. Okay, there is one thing that I need to do here that I forgot. Which was the connections of CANFD here to so we have ECAT MISO and CANFD MISO that are connected together, and they shouldn't be connected together. This should have been a DRC error. They shouldn't be connected together without resistors, but I don't think that this resulted in a DRC error. Actually, it's a good idea I checked the DRC after I made so many changes to the schematic. Pin not connected. Right, I moved that one out, so I think that should be just a no connect. Okay, so this doesn't result in a DRC error, which is probably because the footprint of the CANFD controller doesn't define that pin as output. Or is the other way around? So this one is SDO is an output. And what about the EtherCAT chip? Where is the, let's see, SDO. Right. So, is it that KiCad doesn't produce a DRC error if this pin is an IO? There is somewhere this matrix for the DRC. Where is it? Is it under preferences somewhere? In the general options. Editing, no. Be here. Right, it's here. So if we have an output pin, and output pin is an error, but output pin and bidirectional pin is not an error. Let's make that a warning. Like, by the time Damien answers my question, I've already found it myself, but because of the lag of the video, I can see the comment afterwards. or actually Damien can see the video much later than when I'm actually doing work. So by the time comment comes, I've already finished solving the problem. Would be nice if YouTube was a bit faster. I don't think any of this is really an issue. So I can definitely see why they don't generate an error for bidirectional pins like that. But it simply means that what I have to do is just add a few resistors there, at least for the MISO pin. Just to make sure that if for any reason both chips try to drive that pin, that it doesn't short. Yeah, the magic of YouTube streaming lag. I think that streaming is really the best way to record YouTube videos, because I would never have time to do this if I were recording this and then processing the video, encoding it and uploading it to YouTube. That just wouldn't work. But if I can stream while I'm designing this PCB, it just means that I simply start a script that starts FFmpeg, and then I'm done. So that's the only thing I have to do. So it's just starting a command from the terminal, that's it. And then everything is being streamed, which is perfect. So it's a very efficient way of recording YouTube videos. Right. So these ones, they don't really need resistors. And I shouldn't really have put even resistors on them for the other SPI bus. But now that they're there, I'll just leave them. But they're not really necessary for anything but the MISO pin. Right. Annotate this. And should be able to get the resistors here. And I'll place them, so I have, let's see, I have the SPI connections that go here, I think. And they also have to go to the CAN of D interface here. Why did I place the CAN of D interface there? That was so stupid. I should have placed it here. But it's, yeah. Okay. So this needs to go there. I could actually place these resistors on the back. And also route the other tracks on the back. I just want to see which one is which. So, can I see the signal name? There we go. So, MOSI, STK, and MISO. So this one. And then this goes to the EtherCAT chip. And the other end of it, let's see how this is going to work. This is going to go there. And this one will go there. And also to the SPI. So actually, we should break this connection there. And then this will just go straight to the... Actually, I'm going to go around this. This is why I think it's useful to have a border like this. Because if I had a border here, I would not be able to cross it on any of the signal layers. This one down there. I'll stop there for now, because I want to see if there's anything else that needs to be wired. This can go there, and then, yeah, so this should really go there, but okay. Yeah, I mistakenly thought that that was the same pin. This will have to go like this. Change the width. Okay, and then this one just exits here and connects to the test point and then over there. Okay, 5 volts, make this extend here. So now the create corner is the top item. Why is it a different item every time? I think that's confusing. Sometimes it ends up at the bottom, sometimes in the middle, sometimes at the top. This one needs to be moved a little bit. Okay, refill. Wait, what is this? Did I not wire them up? Or is this actually right? Okay, I see. So this goes to, right, there is a 0 ohm resistor there, that's why. So this actually needs to be just a separate plane. And this will have to be, this is one of the other annoyances of KiCad. I have to either name this net, so actually I'll name this net. Because I can't be bothered to search for a name that is net R51 pad 1. So I'll put a name on this net. ESP They're not sorted either, so it's kind of like, okay, where is it? Where is that net? Did it actually update? Yes, USB power. So this needs to be USB power. Where is USB power? This can also go to the power layer. All right. 142 connections left. I'm gonna take care of these ones. These ones need to go over there. So this is control signals for this digital potentiometer. It controls the analog outputs. Okay, I'm gonna solve this later. Just gonna do a quick route here. And
then this one still needs to go there. So this needs to be, let's see, maybe I'll take care of it after this one. So it may have been smarter to actually... oh, okay, right, it's that one. So that's... that'll just have to go through here. That should be enough space. So this goes here. And then these two, they end up here and here. So this is the I to C. So it would be nice to have this via here instead. And then just go like this on the back. Yeah, actually even... even like this. So if I move this via here, then I can route that one straight here. And probably also it's a good idea to just swap places so that the pins can cross where they reach this chip. So this can go here, and then this I can cross here like this. So, is it time now to rearrange this pin, this tracks here? I'll just rip this one, and then I'll make them more pretty. So this can go all the way around here, and then... where then? There's one track here that is kind of out of place. This goes around like that. This track maybe doesn't even need to go around like that. Let's see, so we got V-cap there. I can connect the V-cap. I'll just connect those pins so that I know how much space I have left. And then I'll reroute that track. I have ground. 3D. Now I should be able to route this track. Let's see. This track. I should be able to route it around here actually. Let's see. I still have a few things that need to go to this connector. It's probably a good idea to wire them up. This will go to the reset. I'm gonna move this tracks a little bit so that I can consolidate the space. So anything that is on the back will take less space here, and then I can see. Come on. Right, and I really want to have these tracks following the same path as the other green tracks. So I'm just rooting like this. That's the suggested way that KiCad wants me to route the track. Have to restart. Yeah, something weird happened again. So this one is actually right. And this one can go here. Nope. This can go here. That. Okay. No. No. KiCad had to ruin my track. Oh shit. I think it's getting too close to that one that ruins this part of the track. Yeah. Can go the other way. So start from here. And I can get them closer. Okay. So just consolidating the space so that I can then just jump over a bunch of tracks when I route the signals here. So this needs to go to the... It can actually go to the button there. It's the same signal. Maybe... Let's see, so this one... This one needs to be... rooted here. I could actually come out here, so if I go around on the back and I come out here, let's see. If I just go here and then just go straight up here. Apparently that's impossible to move for some reason. Maybe this works better. Right, and then this goes then around here. Okay. And I also have this one. This is the USB 5 volt. So this goes to the same connection as this one. I'll leave that for now. I'll just have a look at this part of the board here. So is there anything else that needs to be routed here? This one. Motor brake and it's probably better to just leave this one out. So if I move this wire here and then just leave this one through here, then have a via here and go down through here, and then I have to see, do I really have to, right, actually this would be very. Yeah, this would be a better solution here. So I just take this one and wire it like this. I could, I'm not really sure about the fault signal here. We'll see. I'll start with the brake, and I'll remove that track and that track, and then I'll route this one like this. Let's see. Yeah, and then I can just move these ones a little bit to the side. This is the most annoying part of moving tracks. Yeah. Amazing. What is wrong with this algorithm? course, it's much better than nothing. So it's... I won't complain. I'm not complaining, in fact, I'm just asking questions. Okay. So this, then goes like this, and down here. Finally, it ends up here. That make more sense? No, there's not enough space. So I have to go here. Okay. I remember that this router was actually better. This is something that has cropped up in the latest versions. Okay. So next. VDD3A3. Oh, this. Oh, right. Yeah. This is next to the EEPROM, so. This goes there. I was thinking about this one. So I had some idea about putting this one around here. Yeah, that would be better. I'll delete this segment, and then just not the whole thing, just this segment. And then this segment. And I'll route it around here. I'm just doing this because I want to, let's see, I want to free up a little bit of space there. So I don't want to have too many alternations between the back and front layer. I want to have as few as possible. So I was thinking that maybe if I move this one, this via slightly here, then I can root on the back layer here. It would actually be better to just root on the same layer here instead of going on the back. So it's better to have these tracks on the top layer so that I can then root these tracks on the back layer. Actually, all of them. Maybe. Let's see. Yeah. This is definitely a better idea. And then here I can switch the layer to the back layer. Clean them up in a bit. Just gonna do the routing first. Nope. To restart. drag the cursor behind behind the tracks that are there, which causes KiCad to come up with an alternative path. What would be some ways to improve this algorithm, though? I think it would be nice if it was possible to select multiple vias and then align them and have the tracks follow the vias so that the tracks continue to be connected to the vias. Right now, that's not possible. If I align the vias, I think that will just... that just breaks the connection. So that would be very useful. But also something needs to be done about the way that KiCad predicts how I want to lay out the track. When I move a track, I don't want some other section of that track to be messed up. Nope. It seems to have a problem with the inner corners. Like, any corner that is going this way gets straightened out for some reason. But if I go this way, then this one doesn't get straightened out. So it seems to be a bug. Okay, let's connect the SPI here. So this, first of all, maybe I need to wire this one first. This goes there. Right. These ones will have to go out on the back of the chip, or rather on the back of this row of pins, because I have crystal here. I don't want to have any vias there. Let's see. Maybe I can rewire this pin. This is fault. Right. I could actually do this. So, if I... this would be a perfect candidate, actually. So, rewire fault to GPX int B. Where? This actually connects to... right, that's a pull-up resistor. Okay. So I'll have to move that pull-up resistor as well. Can move it there for now. default will be connected then to where the GPX interrupt was connected. Okay, much better. And then this goes to the fault signal. It's a bit unfortunate that it's connected like that. What's this? Right, this one is PWM input. So that has to be connected there. But maybe something else. Maybe this one can be connected. Would definitely make sense to connect this one somewhere here. What is this? Or current warning. Would it make sense to connect this one to where the or current warning is? Yes, definitely. So I can't move the encoder, or actually, the encoder Z input I could move, because that's just an index pulse. But I'll move the overcurrent warning instead here. So I'll connect the overcurrent warning here. Okay. Ground connections and finally the so this one will go then right here. Alright, I'll wire the other one first. So I have the fault here and I have the overcurrent warning. So I need to move this one a little bit. Maybe this one. Where does this go? It's kind of getting progressively more complex and requiring more jumps through different layers when I come to this last tracks. So I want to try to avoid this as much as possible, placing unnecessary bias. So I need to bring that one here. Can go on the back and then switch to, I can't really switch to the front layer here, so I have to go on the back and then switch to the front layer and then switch to the back layer and then again, right, yeah, this is how I'm going to do it. So I'm going to switch to the front layer here and then to the back layer and then I'll connect it to the bias there. It's already in place. The only issue is actually this track here, this single track. Because it would be nice if I could route it straight across this track, across where this track is. So maybe if I can what is this track? This is a Z pulse. I think the best solution would be if I were to rewire this Z-pulse somewhere else. Maybe actually here. What is this? This is no, this is VMOD sense. I can't rewire that. But I could rewire something that's closer. There's nothing there that is easy to rewire. Maybe one of these. So I have this one actually. Maybe one of these. Yeah, and I could possibly actually go to just follow this path here, maybe. And it would actually simplify. It's actually more important to wire this one there, because that would simplify a lot of routing here. So, overcurrent 2, Mach 2, and Encq Z1. The mock pin is used for setting the mode of the overcurrent protection on the power stage. I think there are two modes. One is pulse skipping, and another one is just cutting the power. So, that's a bit better. And I had an idea that I would, let's see, so this is basically internally connected. think I can solve this issue actually by, let's see. So 1 and 2 is internally connected, and 3 and 4 is internally connected. So in order to remove this this net here, I need to modify the symbol of the reset button, and I have to place the pins at the same sort of the same grid point. So I'll go to the footprint editor and I'll hide pin number 2. This. There we go. Pin number 2. This would be hidden, and it will actually be moved to the same position as. Let's move it there. So I'll move pin number 1 there as well. And pin number 4 also move there, and then hide pin number 3. So this makes KiCad imply that the pins are internally connected. So we can still have those pins on the footprint as different pads. Another way would be actually to change the numbering on the pads. But suppose that we don't want to change the pads, then this is one way to do it. I'm going to change the grid to 10. And I'll delete this polyline. No? Wrong. Oh, actually, yeah, I have to delete both of them. And I'll just draw a line here. Okay, let's see if this works. PCB, and this this little rat's nest line should disappear now. If this is gonna work as intended. Okay. I've never had 13 pins connected together like that. Right, and this didn't seem to work. Interesting. Maybe the only way to do this is actually through the footprint. This shouldn't have a rat's nest line there. I don't want to modify the footprint. I think that's not how it's supposed to work. Yeah, I'm pretty sure this is supposed to work. I'm not sure what is wrong with it now. Maybe, let me just open this again. Maybe they have to be placed in a certain way. So let's see. and they have the same properties. They're both passive. Let's see here. So, I'm just going to do a stupid change. Let's see if this makes any difference. I'm not sure why this doesn't work. I would expect it to work, but it apparently it doesn't work. And it doesn't seem to even get any updates to the netlist, so I don't know really. I'll just connect them like this. So that I can route this other line here. Okay, so this will go then here. Can come out here. And this one. It would actually make more sense here, though, to place this button somewhere else. So we can avoid the whole track that goes all the way around. I think that's a better solution, actually. So I'll delete that one. And then delete that one. Yeah. So just, let's see here. Just because this has to be on the top layer, I can actually place it here. Let's place it like this. And I can then route it like this. So I'll go on the back layer first, start on the back layer, and I'll come out on the front layer here. And go here, here, and finally I have to go back on the back layer. And connect over there. Okay, and next we have a few connections here. This is mainly power connections. I still have to connect the fault pins here. But now I can actually lead them on the back. Maybe if I were to just leave this one here. And then I can leave the fault pins all the way, let's see, yeah, actually all the way here, so all the way here, to have extra bias anyway. The second one will pretty much follow the same path. Do I really have to do it this way? Alright, so this is another analog signal. Okay, I'm going to connect the SPI now. So this is going to be the SPI for the GPIO pins, the extra expansion. It's used for control signals and the LCD. This one is placed a bit unfortunately. And also this one. So I'll move this track here and bend it like this. And then I think. So I have that one also that needs to go to, that's one of the biggest, probably the most important one to remap somehow. So maybe if GPXCS and this one, no, of course not. That won't work because this is. This is the GPXCS. The only thing that I can swap around here is probably this one and one of these pins here. So I could get this one a bit closer to this side of the chip. What is this one? Right, this one is the interrupt. And this one is break, okay. So possibly moving this one somewhere here, swapping maybe this one with something that's coming from here and that ends up here. And gate 2. Definitely. And gate 2. That's a really good change. Yeah, so GPX, let's see. GPX int A will swap places with NGate 2. Come on. Remove this track.
I want this one to take as little space as possible so I can take this end gate line and actually remove this. So. Yeah. So like this.
And just reconnect this one. Okay.
Now it's only this one. It's the most. Actually, maybe this one as well. So I have. What is this? This needs to go there. PWM. Okay. It's probably a good idea to wire up the remaining pins of this chip. So let's see here. So this needs to go. It would be a good idea to actually place this track so that it goes here and doesn't cross the red tracks on the top layer. So I'll place it here and then connect it here. I move it away from other tracks a little bit. So then I can do like this. Actually, maybe this one as well.
free up a little bit of space here. This one also needs to be connected there. So this one is break, right?
So that's the break input for the motor one.
Alles? Land. Yeah, it's static electricity again. It always is static electricity. My dog is rolling on the floor, kind of gets static electricity, and then she gets upset about getting zaps when she continues to roll on the floor. Yeah. So, what would be the best way to solve this problem? I'll continue wiring the connections that are more obvious, and then maybe I'll come up with a good solution to the problem of the routing all the other connections that are currently not so obvious. So I'll just continue with this. I could make this one go around here.
this one needs to actually be connected. It's this one, I think. Yeah. It's this one. GPI reset. So this goes there. Obviously, power shouldn't be connected with a trace. It's GPI reset. This goes here. No, wait. What am I doing? This one. Yeah. And this one then goes there. So yeah. So this can go in between those pins and just follow the path here. Okay, perfect. And just clean up a bit of a mess that KiCad has made there. And next is, you can connect the grounds here. And also, let's see, what is this? This belongs to U13. Yeah. This one's U13. It's supposed to be by pin 9. Let's place it by pin 9. And VDD3D3 basically covers this area here. Thank you. Okay, this one is the contrast, which needs to go there. This one is 5 volts. I think that one is 5 volts as well. So I should be able to just intersect them. Here. And I'll clean up the power layer later. Yeah, that was fine. And then we have this one. Alright. What is this? VDD3E3. And I'll leave that for now. Just move on to the other things that I could connect. For example, let's see, is this? Yeah, this is connected there, but this one needs to be connected. This is the main power connection, so. So this one needs to go here. I'll have to optimize the power connections. See, why am I not getting that selected? There it is. Okay. So this goes to 5 volts. This essentially needs to connect firmly to this inner layer. So let's see. This will have to go like this. GPX reset. Right. Yeah, this will have to be it for this video. Let's see, I just route this one. Just one more track. Just one more track. Yeah. better to route this behind here, actually. And then move the tracks around a little bit so that... Let's see. This one needs to go away. So... This is far from perfect. It's far from perfect yet. This will go like this. Ninety-nine tracks left. You're welcome, Chris. I thought that this was a nice idea to try, sort of this whole thing with live streaming and documenting every step of the process. I was kind of curious, like, how would it turn out? So that's what I'm doing right now, and I think it's interesting to see that it's actually very useful even for me to live stream my work, because I have to, as I explain what I'm doing, it helps me also understand how to make the circuit better. So at the end of this evaluation, I would kind of look at, was this useful also for the quality of my work, and was it useful in any other ways? So obviously it's kind of useful also as a form of marketing, but I think first and foremost, the biggest benefit of this is that I feel that I'm kind of being more attentive to little details, and I get a better understanding, better big picture of the schematic as I try to explain every single part as I'm doing the work. So in that sense, it's very valuable, even for me. And it's nice, the best balance when live streaming is that it's kind of valuable for both the viewer and for me as well. So if I achieve that goal, then it's a success. All right, that's it for this video. I have to go now. It's 4 o'clock here. So, see you next time. Yeah, that's great, Damien. And you helped me figure out the shortcuts for different functions in KiCad, which I sometimes can't be bothered to look up. I have to go over all the shortcuts in KiCad and actually try to figure out why some things don't appear in the list of shortcuts. Why I cannot assign shortcuts to certain things in KiCad, that's really annoying. Okay, I'm gonna stop this video now. Let's see.